made. The nominee expressed to us that it's exactly what he thinks decisions should have, and that he will definitely make sure that he writes in a style where you can clearly understand why the decisions were made. We also spoke to him about the 2188 in particular, if he understood the basis for it, and he did, and he said he would uphold the law as it is. It is interesting to note that just yesterday, the appeal court leaked the decision regarding a 2188, where they did, in fact, overturn an improperly issued restraining order, even though it had expired before the appeal went through. And I think that's very good timing. This makes us feel resolving this issue as possible in the future. So we have no opposition to this nominee. We appreciate his time.
Thank you, Pat.
Thank you.
Councilor Dubrow.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, in all your research with candidates and nominees that sent up here, has anyone ever said that they would not follow the law?
In the beginning, people would argue about what the law was. We used to, there was a time, there was one candidate in particular, when they were asked what the basis of the 2188 was, he did not know the answer. I believe by having this dialogue, it's kind of upping the game for all the nominees that come up here. I think they understand that they need to know what a 2188 is and how it's supposed to be.
I agree with that. I do thank you, sir. What I'm getting at is nominees tell you their opinion of the law.
Yes.
And you will agree with me that two minds can disagree with the lie it says.
Well, the opinion that we're looking for, the opinion that we are getting, is one of those first my knowledge expressed by Counsel Casey. That's the eminent fear of serious physical harm. It used to be, when we talked to the nominees, that their concern was fear, and was a believable fear. Well, that's not the standard. So we're getting beyond the idea that someone can walk in the court and say, I'm afraid to get a restraining order, which was what was going on before. So we're not disagreeing with anything they say. We're looking for a specific standard, and that's the standard that you're coming from each of the candidates.
Right.
Does anybody else wish to speak in opposition to the nominee? Okay, so we'll close the witness part of him. It's all yours.
Well, I appreciate the time this body has afforded me to discuss my credentials with you for this prestigious position on the appeals court. Many of you I have met for the first time. Several of you I've known over the years. I believe that my career of public service has fostered me for this position. Having been a young prosecutor in Massachusetts in my early age of my career, and then working for the Sheriff's Department and getting a wide variety of civil experience, going from there to the District Court in Dorchester, which is a very busy urban court, spending a great amount of time there. Judge Hanlon mentioned that I sat on the side of the drug court there. They also had another specialty court at the time. They had another violence court. I was able to sit in for a little while, and so I really got a great deal of experience sitting in that court. And then when I moved on to the Superior Court, I was able to handle more complex civil matters, sitting in Woburn, Division of the Middlesex Superior Court, afforded me a great opportunity to hear a vast array of different types of civil matters with the 128 group, and all kinds of things from personal injury to complex civil litigation, and just many, many areas of civil disputes, which I really didn't have an opportunity to do quite a bit of as a judge in Dorchester District Court. I did do quite a bit of that when I was counsel for the sheriff's office. So I feel like I'm prepared to move on to the appeals court. It almost feels like a natural progression for my career. I'm excited about the opportunity. I'm excited about the opportunity I have to sit here and discuss those credentials with you, and I'm prepared to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me just ask you, first of all, what do you think of this process here?
It's an important process. I think we're a system of checks and balances, and this plays right into that. I think it's great. great that the governor was able to have a selection process. So I think it's equally as important that another body was able to test that nominee and to weigh in on that decision. So I think that helps build trust and public trust and confidence. And I think it's really important to open trust.
You think just because the governor nominated you, that we should vote for you?
I'd like to think that.
So, okay.
But no, I don't think that. I think you have an independent job to do. You all took oaths as elected officials, and I think you have to stand by the oath that you took. And sometimes that's making difficult decisions, and I appreciate and respect that.
So, whatever way councilors vote, you would respect
it. I would respect it.
What did you do in preparation for this hearing?
Well, I've been to this hearing a couple of times before, so I was somewhat familiar with how this hearing was going to be conducted. I've done it twice already. But I also went back and listened to some of the hearings of some of the appeals court justices who recently gone through this process. Reviewed my materials, my application, and my questionnaire.
You applied for the judicial nomination. And tell me about that. How did that, what happened?
You send your application in. If you're fortunate enough to get an interview, you have an interview with 21 members of the JNC, and all 21 were there when I had my interview in 20. The interview lasts maybe 15 or 20 minutes. They ask you a bunch of different questions, fielded from whoever wants to ask a question, chaired by Ms. Dacier. Following that, I was fortunate enough to get nominated from the JNC. That was the process for the JNC.
Let me just stop you there. This is pretty important. You're on an important court. You're going to a very important court. You agree with me? So the JNC gets a copy of your application and then has a meeting with you in the last 15 minutes. Correct?
I think mine was maybe 20 minutes.
Myself. Yeah. How many questions do you think we're asking? Do you think that's sufficient to be able to determine whether or not somebody could be nominated? Now, I know it's the process. Your answer is only to be thankful, other than I want to hear what you have to say. Do you think, looking at somebody's application, let's excuse a little bit, somebody's application and asking questions for 15, 20 minutes is sufficient to determine whether or not somebody should be nominated?
Well, the short answer to that question is probably sometimes. I don't know that everybody's experience is just my experience, so I can't speak to how they do all of the candidates. I know that they were very prepared for me when I got there. They knew quite a bit about my application, and so it seemed to be that there's been a lot of stuff going on in the background before I even got there relative to my application. It's a system that seems to work. So I thought it would work okay.
You know, applications are great. It's a great way to get information about somebody. I consider them much like resumes. I've never heard of anybody in my entire life say that an application or a resume can put down critical things about themselves. Have you?
I have.
So, you know, you'd have to be a fool to do that, right?
I would think.
So, we get applications, and it's all good stuff, and people you put down, I do, puts down people to call. And I have never heard of anybody putting down somebody to call that would say you had a very bad experience, or you had words with them, or whatever. You know, we don't get somebody to call the guy and he says, oh, Jesus, I had a fight with him in the courtroom and he did this as a DA or a lawyer. We always get weight should we give an application?
I think each person has to determine that for themselves. I think we should give an application as much weight as you think it deserves based on what's contained in the material.
So you listened to some tapes about judges that were came through us from the appeals court. And you listened to the questions that we asked.
Not all of them. Listened to the team there to get a flavor of how things were being conducted in that area. Can't say that I listened to anyone after his entire hearing or anyone from counselors' entire questions.
So you did listen to some counselors ask a question and the nominee responses. And aside from the fact that you're going to tell me you were preparing for this, what benefit of that was to you?
For me, it was a comfort in knowing that it was pretty much what I had done before, not much different from that. So I didn't really feel that I needed to listen to a lot of it because it was a process that I'd gone through, and it seemed to be very similar in kind to the same thing that I had done. So I was assured, gave myself some self-assurance that I knew what you expect.
Did you have any sit downs with anybody from the administration with regard to what questions you might ask?
Not about what questions. I certainly met with Sharon Casey about being prepared and kind of logistically about how this was going to go. That was the only person that I met with regard to the administration.
So you didn't do a mock hearing? You ever heard of that? We went through this council twice before. Did you ever do a mock hearing? Where eight people sit around pretend they're counselors and they ask questions of the nominee?
I know the mock hearing, I've never done one.
Did you think you would have needed one of those?
I don't think that you can ever be over prepared. I think I've gone through some real hearings, so I didn't need a mock one. But you can never be over prepared.
Well, you've been in the legal business how long?
25 years. 25 years. You knew me as a young DA yourself.
So you're coming in here having had the experience of a couple of those kinds of hearings, and you're applying for hires in the same business you've been in for 25 years. Right? So you didn't expect to come in here and we would ask you about the theory of relativity, would you?
I didn't expect that.
No.
Hope you don't.
Or or we're gonna ask you about the plumbing code to type a house, would you?
I would hope so.
Okay. We're asking you questions about what you've done for the majority of your life. You've been involved in. And you have 25 years of experience. And you could probably handle just about any question any counselor could ask you about the judicial system, couldn't you?
I'd like to think I could handle most. I don't know if I could handle every question. Okay. A lot of bright lines in here. So
and there may be things that you don't know, because there's things that we all don't know. In preparing for this, you sort of knew from your experience in the court system sort of what we're going to ask you about topics that concern the courts.
I mean, I had some idea, I think it's fair to say. I don't know exactly, but I have some idea. Well, you're going to ask me about my career and about why you think maybe I'd be a good candidate to be an appeals court judge. Perhaps how my career has, possibly to be an appeals court judge, and what I may be able to contribute to the appeals court. Why now in my career? Those are the questions that many questions that I got from the JNC, and I thought they'd be similar. Time.
Let me ask. last year. You have had, I read your application, you've had some experience in the juvenile court system. Back when you first started.
Very limited, yes.
And you've had some experience in district courts, lawyer and the spirit. Do you think that's important for you in the early years?
I think it benefited me. It exposed me to an array of different issues that make much of me appeal for. Given the experience of many different cases, I think cases are all different. You see a lot of the same charges, but they're different. They're different people, they're different motivations, they're different. And it's always been my practice to address cases on a case-by-case analysis. I think that experience and having to wrestle with issues that may have been unfamiliar to me. I've been fortunate enough to sit on a very collegiate court for the Boston Municipal Court or the Superior Court, where others have had more experience than I have. I've looked out there and been very willing to share that knowledge with me. Really long. I don't think any of the star seasoned judges, at least I certainly didn't, it takes a while to kind of find your stride.
Have you ever gone into the probate
court?
Land court.
Never gone into the land court. I've had some land court issues, but I've never gone into the land court.
Housing court. All of those courts are going to produce decisions. Do you think it's important as an appeals court judge to kind of go down and know what's going on in those courts? The judges put up with in those courts, and you know what they put up with in the district and the superior. But if a probate issue comes up to you when you're sitting in the appeals court, do you think it'd be important that you know like what judges deal with down in that court and how things work?
I think that certainly could be helpful. I know that there are judges on the appeals court who have experience in those areas, and I've served on several committees with judges from those courts. And so we share our experiences and issues that they have to wrestle with. And so I've been on committees with land court judges, I've been on committees with probate court judges. I've done some housing landlord tenant, as you very well know, in the district court. And so I've got some idea, am I an expert in those areas? No, I certainly don't see that on a day-to-day basis, but I have some idea of the issues, and some of the issues that they wrestle with are issues that all of us.
If you're confirmed, do you think it would be maybe a good idea to take a day and see the probate judge?
I think it probably could be helpful. Sometimes, you know, you don't know what you don't know, and so once I start seeing some issues that come. Or it may be helpful for you to sit in that court to watch a particular hearing or to learn more about the type of
I believe Chief Judge Catherine is here today. She's sort of an advocate for the appeals court. It's happening to know what's going on in those courts. Feel for it.
That's great.
Yeah. So you wouldn't be against it.
I love the courtroom.
Is there a dress code for the courts?
It's not a dress code.
So if somebody comes in with a bow tie, suit like yours, they're okay.
They're okay. I thank them. Yeah. I thank them.
Have you ever fined anybody or sent them home because of the way they were
done? I may have. I can't say. If I sit here right now, I can't recall an instance, but I don't think that I'd be beyond that. I may have. They came in and they were properly tied.
And
What do you mean by that? What's being proper?
Well, it's hard to say sometimes because you don't know anyone's background. Maybe they've got on the cleanest shirt that they have. That's fine. I'm not a fan of the tank top t-shirts. You know, the wife beater shirts is another term for them. I haven't had any of these issues, I'll say, on the Superior. But in the Dorchester Division of the District Court, some of these things may have crept in time or two. Coming in with t-shirts, snitches get stitches. I think that's inappropriate. I may have sent somebody home.
Aside from t-shirts of kind of verbal comments, you would agree with me that there's some people that don't have the funds.
I would agree with that 100%.
I understand. And some people think they dress nice, but you may not.
Reasonable minds can do. I mean, sometimes we don't know.
And some people may have come from the background with no bigger truck.
Exactly right.
Did you ever find a lawyer for being late?
No.
In district court?
No. Have
you ever heard of any judges?
I've heard a story. I couldn't call out a judge's name who's done it. I've heard of judges who've done it.
No. Why not?
I don't like it. This is the finding of lawyers. Sometimes lawyers have legitimate reasons as to why they're late. Got a number of cases in the district courts, and they're trying to do their best to get to different places and only be in one place at a time. But I'm not anxious to find more than
do you know of any law that gives the best power to find a lawyer?
Off the top of my head, I don't know. I couldn't say.
Have you ever held a lawyer in contempt and put him in the back? That is what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, it's not for me to second guess another judge's behavior. That judge felt compelled to do that. And that was his or her decision to do that. And in the courtroom, I wasn't sensitive to be keeping facts and circumstances around me. So, as I sit here right now,
that's not something you would do.
Certainly
not. That would be some sort of extreme conduct. Have you ever used guidelines?
Those are the guidelines, and I think that it's important to be the most informed that I can be. I'm not married to guidelines, I'm a firm believer in judicial discretion. But I look at the guidelines, it helps give me some sense as to what the government's offer may be, relatively speaking, what the defense offer may be, relatively speaking. In the toolkit, but it's not the first thing that I review or look at assessing the value of the case.
Do you know people on the commission that advise those guys?
I don't know some of them. I don't know who you call a name, but I can tell you I know this person, I know that person, but they sit here. I don't know.
You haven't been adopted by the legislature. Not law, right? They have no force or effect. Of course, our instances. They seem to have thrown out the federal system.
I guidelines. Yeah, we're doing that. Practicing the federal court a little bit with the council, the sheriff.
These guidelines are effective and fair and the federal system.
Haven't done enough.
What do you think of the probation scandal that we had here?
Unfortunately, very unfortunate. That was sad.
What do you think of the system now?
I think it's better. It's better. I think it's trying to get better. I think there's a lot of work to be done to try to raise more out. Generally, probation officers are hardworking people. I don't think that anybody gets into probation unless they're in it to help. Probation isn't something that you just kind of raise your hand and say, I'm going to do it. I'm just looking for a job. A lot of people have really good intent and are really looking to help the lives of others and choose probation as a profession. Going out of course, trying to get better.
How does a probation officer, 250 or 300 cases, see probation officers once a month? It's physically impossible.
Seems like.
You get to put more money in than I am, probation officer?
I think they should put more money into the probation department. I think that they could maybe use some of their resources more efficiently. Whether you need to have probation officers all the time in the courtroom, whether you need to have probation officers. The type of cases that they're supervising, I think there's a priority of cases that can be addressed by the use probation officers. I think they also have assistant PPOs, assistant probation officers, and they might be able to more efficiently use some of the bodies that they have. But I'm sure probation has budget problems.
What do you think, minimum mandatory
sentence? Not
it could work.
Imagine they work in some instances, almost if they never work. I'm not paying up. Like I said before, I'm not.
Why not do it?
Because I believe that. I don't think any two cases are the same. Two people can commit the same crime. And for me, he treated very differently. And so, that mandatory minimum, sometimes you're not able to treat them very differently. Sometimes there's going to be facts, and I think facts matter. Two people might get treated differently, committing the exact same crime.
We, at least, big we, colleague.
I have to follow the law. And if I'm able to not sentence him to that mandatory minimum of the law, then I might try to do it. There are instances where my hands are tied. And that's the function of the legislature to try to change the basic field of justice to be done to address those issues. In the case you're talking about, again, I'm not super intimately aware of exactly all of those facts. But I believe that judge wrote a little bit about why they felt that that person deserved this position. And I think that
Judge Faison seemed to die, wasn't it?
Well, I don't think so. I think she was able to, and again, I'm not sure, but there may have been some area where deviating from it and writing a little bit about why she deviated from it may provide that's in power. I don't know if the decision is over right now.
The DA appealed the decision of the law. So the question is, would you write a little something? You thought you could make the decision you made. I mean, what's going to happen to you when you do that? I'm not going to fire you.
I don't know.
Get the governor to do that, and we got a vote on it. We wouldn't do that.
Whatever happens, I'm just going to involve stress. Because I think it's stressful when you're talking about whether they're going to fire you or not.
Well, they can't fire you.
I would hope.
I mean, if you did what she did, you know we can fire her, right?
As far as I know.
That's the act. She said this kid shouldn't get the minimum mandatory, and I'm not going to give him.
And her first name.
Well, I don't know if Judge Desmond, in the circumstances, you feel imposing the minimum mandatory would be unfair and unjust to somebody when you would do the same thing.
I don't know. I like to believe that I'm a man of character. But I think the law is the law. Sometimes we're bound by it.
I mean, I'm sure Judge Frieson, if he was here, would say the same thing. Probably would say, in this case, it's unfair and unjust. So they appealed her, and he'll probably get reversed, and he'll get the minimum mandatory back. But she took a stand. If more judges did that, you may not have the minimum mandatory.
That may be one avenue of change.
So, Judge Desmond, we want you to be one of those people.
I'll keep that in mind.
Nobody can fire you.
I'll keep that in mind.
The best they can do is transfer you out to Springfield or Pittsfield, and you'll love it out there.
I've lived in those areas before. I like the East Coast.
That's all I can do to you. You can't take your pay away from your pension or anything else. Well, speaking of guts, it was a judge in the federal court who wouldn't impose criminal sentences under the guidelines. Judge Allen, did you know him? So he refused to sit. Cases where he would have to impose that. He said it's an unfair system. It is the executive dictating to the judiciary what sentences. That's it. Me judges with guts, me judges to speak out. We're going up there with Judge Cather, and he'll want you to speak out. Even if he yells it.
I've never been one shy of speaking out.
Do you think we incarcerate too many people of color in the North? Why do we do that?
That's a difficult question. I don't know. Implicit biases. I think we're trying to figure that out in society now.
Well, I mean, I have seen kids come through Rock Springs, but just don't keep that out. It always amazes me if I have a young man in his 20s who grew up in that area, just in any record. What do you think of eyewitness identification?
I think the changes that they've made recently are positive changes. We're learning more about eyewitness identification. We're learning more about the science of it.
What?
We're learning that, you know, the mind, I think there was a belief for a long time that the mind was kind of like a video camera. And, you know, what you kind of saw was embedded in your mind as a movie, perhaps. It was just a matter of being able to kind of play that movie back in your mind we're running now, the sign says the line is not going to be a change. There's a number of factors that can influence an eyewitness identification. Whether or not there's a stressful situation at the time of the occurrence. Sometimes they say cross-racial identification is more difficult than not. The conditions at the time, lighting conditions, things of that nature. We're running off of those things. The fact that somebody said I was 99% sure really is no moment when it comes to eyewitness identification. So I think those are all things that we've learned over the time, and now we're starting to form a jury of them. On their determining whether or not it's a credible or not. I think it's
good.
System, whatever, you get the same level of efficiency. So I think it's unfortunate. I favor the court reporters, particularly in the criminal case where people would be interested. I think I'm sure you've seen transcripts for something didn't get picked up. It could have been pertinent, and that was with the court reporter. So I don't know if any symptoms can be.
They say to you, I'm on motion for funds for a court report. It's very
good. Good chance that I probably allow one. I don't know that I would have that motion before me on the appeals court. But my present thought is to be grateful. I sit here right now. I can't wait for good reason.
What do you think of specialty courts we had that are in the local drug court? You did a drug court? You ran a drug court.
Well, I did one for 5 years and I saw the lines that have been saved. Again, I try to look at it. What's motivating the criminal conduct? What's underlying the criminal conduct? Sometimes it's mental health, sometimes it's both. You don't know it until you're able to sober some of the other and you realize that they may have a mental health issue. It's even more compounded sometimes when there's a language issue. And so they can't tell you. There's such a rotten stigma on mental health issues. Nobody wants to say, I think I have a mental health problem or self-medicate or think I'm, you know, have. They want to say it. Particularly in person can have a drink, have heroin, have whatever, not be addicted. One person can have just one and be addicted the rest of their life. I don't think anybody chooses to be that. I think it's a difficult existence for the addict. But the reality of life is that I'm sure everybody in this room is affected by the addiction in one way or another.
Somebody's addicted to heroin. They think they have a choice. Put it down.
I think they have a choice to try to help with the addiction. I don't know if they have the choice. It might be such a driving force, not being that in itself. It might be such a driving force that to just say, hey, put it down, cut it out, that may not be realistic. But they have a choice about whether or not they're going to seek professional help and do the best that they can do to try to beat the addiction. I think I read a statistic on that 99%.